Welcome to Trapping Across America, where fur brothers meet every week. But we're still allowed to be men, and we're proud to be from the land of the fur and the home of the brave. Hello everyone, this is your host Clint Locklear from Trapping Radio. Today we're going to be interviewing Scott Welch. He's from Ohio. Many of you know him from the trapping conventions. He's got a book out and I believe a DVD. He also is a lure maker, but he's one hell of a trapper and he's a good friend of mine. And I really appreciate him taking his time up at the NTA to allow me to interview him about some different things. You're going to find we go all over the board with it, from different styles of trapping to trapping full time to making more money while you trap and using methylparaben in your lure and bait making. So we're covering the full gamut of the whole thing. I think you're really going to enjoy it. He's a great guy. And if you have some questions or you're looking for some good lure, Scott's a very good choice for you to pick. Now, our sponsor this week is Oki Trap and Cable, and that's oktrapsupply.com. You can also reach them at 918-429-4648 to reach Jeb at his shop. And he's always running specials every month. If you're looking for traps, guys, I'm telling you, he's one of the most honest guys you'll ever deal with. And you'll thoroughly enjoy the experience with him. And I'm going to talk a little bit about his body grip traps today. He carries Belials, which are the Cadillacs. He carries Bridgers, which are good, Dukes, which are good. And he also carries the RGB traps. Those are the round conibear traps that really fit in some neat situation. And to you ADC guys out there, if you're doing some urban stuff, there's a lot of uses for those traps that sometimes the square ones just don't work out quite for you. But if you're in the market for some good body grip traps coming up this fall to catch some of this high-priced fur, go to oktrapsupply.com. And Jeb will be more than glad to help you out. Before we get to the interview, the Predator Control Group product of the week is our Making Bait and Lure Trips, Tips, and Methods. It's a 4-hour DVD, guys, that covers a ton of information. It covers everything from glands to essential oils to tinctures to lure bases, bait bases. A lot of the stuff in there is, you know, how can you save money as a trapper? How can you make your own fish oil that is probably as good or better than you're going to find at a convention? You making your own trailing scents for raccoons. How are you not going to lose money when you start playing with the lure and bait? Because there's a lot of ingredients that if you treat them a certain way, they're absolutely going to disappear, or you're not going to like the results from them. And when I go into a lot, like I said, it's 4 hours. It covers glands to oils to baits to lures and all kind of different things in between. So now let's get on with the show and see what Scott has to say. Okay, Scott, why don't you kind of give us a rundown of where you're from, how long you've been trapping. That's kind of how we start all these, so let everybody know who you are.
Okay, Clint, my name's Scott Welch. Like Clint just said, I'm from Ohio, North Central Ohio. Been trapping since I was about 10 years old, so that makes about 28 years now. Started like a lot of guys did, just trapping muskrats close to home. And my grandpa, he was always a big firm believer. He didn't buy lures and baits, so we always made all that stuff starting out. And
is that who got you started in it? Was your granddad?
Yeah, absolutely. And so I've kind of been doing the one along with the other. He was always a big tinker. We made trap swivels, made baits, and did the trapping too. So I kind of learned all that all together. So just started trapping muskrats in on my own a little bit when I was young too. He'd always give me a few traps and send me down to the creek to play around a little bit. And he's always real proud when you'd bring something home that you caught on your own. So that was good. And I always tell guys, my grandpa was never a very good teacher, I never thought, but he always gave me an opportunity to learn. And now that I'm older, I think maybe that's what being a good teacher is really all about. So
teaching you to think.
Absolutely, absolutely. I made a lot of mistakes, but I learned real quick too. So. And then just kind of progressed from that and starting up through and, you know, trapping coons and then some fox. And then when we started getting coyotes in Ohio, trapping coyotes. And, you know, just like most guys, just kind of progressively evolved up. And then, you know, really got bit in high school and man, that was all I ever wanted to do, and kind of still think that way. So actually, I just used a line in an article here not too long ago. I can remember one of the few times I got to sell fur before the market really tanked, and I think we averaged about 37 on our coons that year. And you could buy Montgomery 1.5 coils for $32 a dozen. And we went in the fur buyer and sold coons, and we come out of there with our arms full of Montgomerys and pockets full of money, and we thought, man, we can do this for a living. Right. Problem is, some guys like me are still thinking that and trying to make a go at it. But yes, that's just kind of how things got started.
Well, the price is coming up, though. I think there, one thing, tell me if you've heard this at the convention, because we're at the NTA, and what I'm noticing this year, more than any other time, our guys are going, I've quit my job, I think I can do this full time, and it seems like there's going to be so many guys that at least part time for that time of year are going, you know, they're planning on making house payments. And
absolutely, I think, and I've been hearing that, and I think that always kind of ties in more, and I think you've mentioned this too, Clint, talking the last few years, when the economy gets soft, guys are out of work, they look at it a little more serious,
right,
as far as maybe I can make a go at this full time. Now it is, I wouldn't say it's impossible, because I don't think anything's impossible, but it's damn tough. If a guy's going to go 12 months on a fur check, I just don't know if a fellow can do it. You start looking at fuel costs and replacement costs on vehicles and ATVs, that's a tough road to hoe. Now, as far as what guys quote-unquote call sprint professional trapper, which is what a lot of us do, just making money off fur checks, can you do it? Absolutely. Do you have to adjust your lifestyle to be able to do that?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Your wine's going to have screw-off caps that you drink. You're going to drive older pickup trucks. Your wife's going to be a little naggier on you about certain things. But, I mean, if a guy wants to make a go at it, absolutely. And I think there are more guys that's starting to look at it more from a quote-unquote professional trapper standpoint. And I think the thing that really jumps out at guys quick, when you're trapping part-time, you're making a decent catch and you're looking, man, I'm selling some $30 coons. Some of my coyotes bought $50 and $55. You know, this, I think I could make a go at this. But you start pushing that pencil very long at all. You start being honest with yourself on the averages and then what you're putting into that line every day. Mm-hmm. Fuel costs, gear costs, lure and bait costs. It can really slap some reality into you in a big hurry. Yeah.
Well, to me, guys that want to do that, like, and if I'm wrong on this, no one hold this against me, but I've had several guys saying that Phil Brown got on T-Man showing $125,000 fur check.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he held a year or two or whatever. Still phenomenal and great.
Absolutely.
For Phil.
Tim and Brent Sawoski selling muskrats up out of Minnesota and South Dakota, same way, them big six-figure fur checks, yeah.
So, but to do what they're doing, especially Phil, the expenses that are going into the way he's going into it, you've got to have that nest egg to start with, or you're going to run out of money before you have a chance to really.
Absolutely. And that's one thing when I started to really try to make a go with this. There's a lot of winners when you buy Raymond noodles by the case because they're 14 cents a pack. I've rolled quarters to buy gas in between fur checks. I mean, you do whatever the hell you got to do. And that's a real hard, fast reality check when you start trying to do that. And I think guys that's trapped for 2 or 3, 4 weeks, even if they're trapping hard, you know, they've put money back from the job all summer long. They're not worried about buying gas in between fur checks and stuff. And that does. This scares a fella sometimes. I mean, you're really walking a tightrope.
Absolutely. Well, the habit I'm still in that drives Cindy, my wife, crazy is if someone, we're at a store and we buy coffee and it's $1.27 and I got $2, I always pay $2. I put that change in my pocket and we got a great big glass jug and I just keep putting change in it, even though I had to in the last few years, because I'm so used to the days when I made a living just for fur. That would get me through a couple weeks of gas.
Absolutely. Whenever you're broke, $100 is a hell of a lot of money.
Yeah.
My grandma always told me growing up, she said, always putting something back for a rainy day because it's always going to rain.
Absolutely. It sure is. But yep. And another thing that I've really noticed, especially at conventions and also on the phone, that I think is just absolutely fascinating from guys that are getting more serious about it but not thinking professionals. A lot of guys are getting buyouts from the companies and they're retiring at 40 and 50.
Absolutely.
And it's like I've been waiting my whole life to go do this, and I mean they're gearing up hard.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I'm proud of them for doing it, but part of me goes, why did you wait so long?
Yeah, and I've noticed that a lot of guys, and I guess a trapping trade isn't different, but you see a lot of guys, they've kind of knocked around from job to job. They've always known what they wanted to do. They've always been a little bit scared. And I think you hit a guy, he's in his, like you mentioned, in your 40s. You're in your late 30s, early 40s. Physically, you're still pretty capable. You can do whatever you want. And boy, mentally, you get sharp about that age group, I think, to where you're really at your best. And I had a doctor tell me once, he said, from about 35 to 55, those are your power years. He said, that's when you earn your money. And I think that's right. I mean, why'd you wait so long? And I agree, but for a lot of times that's just things in your life are finally starting to line up to where, okay, this is what I want to do. I know I can do it. I'm going to get serious about it. Yeah.
Well, another thing, the opposite of what Phil and the guy you mentioned, mm-hmm. and that are doing, I mean, just unbelievable fur checks.
Just mind-boggling.
Yeah. I mean, I have some really good years, but I've never...
Six figures is unbelievable.
No. You know, kudos off to them, but mm-hmm. kind of the way I've been looking at it lately... Because fuel keeps getting higher, no matter what the oil price is, and traps are getting crazy. Like someone was telling me today that CDRs, that I've got all these CDRs I use on my cat, now they're almost $400 a yep. dozen. And that took me for a surprise. And I saw the KB5.5s, they're pushing $300 a dozen. And I bought all these in the past when they weren't that expensive.
Right.
Well, the part, and tell me what you think about this, the opposite of what Phil or what I used to do, you know, putting on 35,000-40,000 miles a year, mm-hmm. the other extreme of that you can still make money with these fur prices more than I think people realize is get out of the Western mindset of covering miles and learn how to use a canoe, learn how to use your feet, do a lot of things that cost you no money. So, because like in any business, I don't care what you gross, it's what you get to take home.
Absolutely.
At the end of the day.
Right. Yep, and there's a saying, cash flow pays bills, but profit makes you money.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can cash flow a lot of money to pay a lot of bills, but at the end of the year, you really haven't made a lot of profit. And that's actually, I just had a student here in Indiana this summer, and that's what I told him. We were, you know, checking coyote line. I said, you ever stop and see any dog-proof coon traps and all these creeks and bridges you drive? He said, nah. I said, if you were driving down the road and there's a $20 bill, would you hop out and get it? And he said, yeah. I said, that's about how long it takes to put a dog-proof under a bridge.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, I never thought of that way. I said, you pay for your gas every day on the line just trapping coons out of dog-proof traps. And I think you're right. I think guys, especially with this high fuel cost, and I've been leaning that way myself, is I don't want to drive by fur. I don't want to put 300 miles on a truck every day because it's hard to make money doing that.
Mm-hmm.
It's fun. That's what we all like. It's sexy and it's addictive. But sexy and addictive, I've tried to take that to the bank before, and they don't always like that. They like cash money. So absolutely, I agree 100%. I think you even mentioned that in your Eastern Woofer book,
mm-hmm.
about everybody gets that mindset, well, that's how I'm supposed to trap coyotes. And that doesn't always work. I mean, you can hamstring yourself by thinking that's how you have to do it.
Well, I remember when I first got started and I was making a living off of $7 coon and a $9 beaver and mm-hmm. $40 otter. And,
which year in and year out, that's what you do.
Yeah. I mean, that's the way it is.
Yep.
And I did it so much different then because I didn't have the money to do what I wanted to do. And then once I got to have the money that I could do it, I could run these really long lines, like on bobcats.
Mm-hmm.
I've got the land and the guys that go with me. It allows me, when I go to Texas, I cat trap. Well, we're doing control work for coyotes and cats and raccoons. Well, that's what I'm paying them for,
right.
So I'll let them do that, and mm-hmm. I cat trap. But if I wasn't in that situation, like this year, because of beaver prices, when I hadn't seen beaver prices, my wife can drop me off at one bridge, and I can float down all day long, and this slam beaver for zero money.
Exactly, zero. The capital's paid for, the canoe's paid for, you got peanut butter and jelly sandwich in the canoe. That's a cheap line to run.
And it doesn't cost any. We got otter, but it's not going to have the... And I think guys are trying to make this jump. When you go to the money side, unless you can pull off what some of these guys are doing with the muskrat price,
mm-hmm.
and that's not going to last forever.
No.
Or the $800 cats, and that's not going to last forever. if you can start going back to the older ways of when you like Bill Nelson used to walk.
Absolutely.
Bud Hall used to walk.
That's right.
And
or use a two-wheel drive car. Yeah.
Yeah. And so the max that you come in, you don't have to sit back out. Because I know in Texas, we got three trucks running, 13, 14 hours a day, and I'm paying that gas bill. Yeah, we're making a ton of money, but we're spending a ton of money.
Absolutely right. Yep, and that number you're done with when you start subtracting all them expenses out, that's the one that matters day in and day out. Absolutely.
So you, what got you into wanting to do commercial lure? What is your, in case someone doesn't know, what do you do besides traff? I mean, because you do some commercial stuff.
And like a lot of guys, you mean as far as lure and bait wise, business wise? Yeah, I have a lure and bait line, well, just high production lures and baits. And been messing around, like I said, when I started out, always made baits with, you know, Grandpa, because he's just tight-fisted old Republican. He wasn't going to buy baits, so. And just started, and actually the thing that really bit me, I was about 18, and that's when, you know, really wanted to be a trapper too. And Blackie, Carroll Black, asked me to work the Nationals with him out in Waterloo, Iowa, 92, which is the year I graduated high school. I mean, I went out there and spent the weekend with him, and that was it. I was hooked.
You were hooked.
I was hooked. And that's just from the outside of that business looking in, it's glamorous. You're at the convention, guys want to meet you, you know, you're signing stuff, and you look, you see guys lined up, and you think, man, that's the easy way to make a buck. And it does look like that, but that's a tough living. If I was to start over again, and I love that, that's as addictive to me as the trapping, as making good lures and baits. I love that. I love guys sending pictures and telling you, Bo, I really killed them on this. That's a lot of fun. But if I wanted to be a trapper, I don't know necessarily if being in the lure bait business is maybe the best thing to do. I love it, but it's not right for everybody, that's for sure. But and like I said, it's almost as addictive as a trapping. I enjoy that aspect of it as much as a trapping, and you have to, or you just never survive it. Yeah.
Did Carroll Black ever like take you under his arm and kind of guide you along?
I mean, as far as like a mentor, yeah, he's been a good mentor to me business wise. As far as showing me much, I mean, he has, yeah, but he's real old school that way, like a lot. And I'm the same way. I mean, you've got to be careful. A lot of those lessons you've learned, you spent a lot of money to learn those lessons,
and you're
awful guarded. And it's not that you're being a jerk about it. It's just that's the nature of the business. Is you've got to be careful with some of that information you hand out. You spent a lot of years and a lot of money trying to figure those things out. So, and we're all secretive in this business to a certain extent, and
even to each other.
To each other, there's certain things, and people see us at conventions, think, man, them guys all get along good, and we do to a certain point.
Mm-hmm.
But we're all trying to make a living at it.
Each other's table smelling the good lure going.
Exactly. I wonder what he's got in that. Yeah. Yep.
Now, I'm going to say something that because I get this question all the time, and I always send them to you one way or another anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Methylparaben.
Okay.
You're the guy kind of that I know that you get that from.
Mm-hmm.
So just explain that one thing that you know that for guys that are using it for the bacteria and
for preservatives. Yep.
Yeah, because it's different than sodium.
Absolutely. To do a real simple layman's explanation on that, sodium benzoate, which has, you know, been used forever in meats and glands and stuff, it's salt based sodium. Methylparaben, anything that's a paraben. And I tell guys, you read food ingredient labels, it's in everything you eat or put on your body. It's in foods, it's in shampoo, it's in conditioner, it's in hand lotion. Parabens cover a much wider pH range than what sodium benzoate will. So it's stopping bacteria, it's stopping molds, it works quicker than sodium benzoate, and it holds odors and flavors better, which doesn't always apply to us in the trapping trade, but it'll hold those smells and flavors better than sodium benzoate can, and that's why it's used in the food and in the fragrance industry so much.
So if you're PMing me or emailing me about, you know, you're having some problems with your that, and I'm telling you,
methylparaben.
Yep. Scott here's the guy. Now, do you have a internet site?
Yep, I have a. You can go to the website www.welshlures.com, and actually, we're getting ready to launch a new site on that. So you guys keep an eye out for that. But yeah, and methylparaben, we sell that by the pint on the site and in the catalog. But if guys need more, we buy that hundreds of pounds at a time, and actually got to buy enough of it that a guy can afford to use it. And it is a little hard to find. Like you said, that's something we get a lot of questions on, and a lot of guys
absolutely
send them to Scott. But But yeah, and I get that question a lot, and I like explaining that to fellas so they understand what it is and what they're using. Absolutely.
Because most of the time when I'm sending people to you, that it's a fish based to something someone's playing around with.
Right, and the two that are bad is fish and fruit, because they like to mold so well, and that'll really help with that.
Yep. And it keeps it from souping up.
A lot better. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. And fish is just one of those things. It's tough to hold, but the methylparaben does a better than anything else I've found. Absolutely.
Let's talk a little bit about killing something.
Okay, absolutely.
Well, you started off with the rats.
Yep.
And then, like an interview I did this morning from a guy in Iowa. Mm-hmm. I know how to catch rats the way I know how to catch them.
Okay.
And I'm not very good any other way. I just kind of caveman my way through that.
Mm-hmm.
If you weren't using colonies, how did you learn, and what are you using for muskrats? Because your land's pretty close to mine, we just have bigger hills.
Right, yeah. As far as rats, and like a lot of guys in the East, you know, we don't have a lot of rats. But colonies outside of that, you know, guys that want to catch numbers, at least in my area, that's what guys are doing.
The colonies.
Using colonies, traps, and finding dens and runs and hitting them heavy and moving them. And I think that's a big key, is keeping them moved quick every 2 to 3 days, because you're catching a lot of rats quick. And one, I don't see the need to. And two, if you're wanting to make money at it, to stay there and catch a colony trap that's got one or two rats in it, you're really not doing yourself any favors. And if I was to just... If I was in that same type area, drainage ditch type area, small creeks that's got dens and runs, if I couldn't use colonies, you know, just use 110s and set them heavy, and then move and set them heavy and move.
So you never played with lure very much?
Not on rats too much. Now, I did do, I had 3 or 4 seasons, I trapped some marshes up along Lake Erie when I had some open water there. And that hut trapping, in Ohio, we can't hut bust, but we could set on the hut, you know, early on open water. And then I would, you know, set huts and use a lure, use some sort of eye appeal bait. I've used potatoes, used apple, used baby carrots. Baby carrots I found the best, because I can buy a bag of them cheap.
And
they go a long ways, and I get hungry, I can eat them. Right, absolutely. And using lure there on the huts. As far as being honest with fellas, I'm not even sure. If you can find on the hut where they're crawling out using leg holds, lure bait helps. I don't know if it's a necessity, but absolutely so. And then, like the guys that's been killing the rats out in the South Dakota, those are on floats. And, you know, when those guys got water, there's so many rats that I don't think them guys are grassing in floats or anything. There's just anything that'll float and hold a trap, and rats will climb on it.
So. So then I'm sure, and I may be wrong, you graduated from rats and went into coons.
And went into coon trapping, yep.
And were you doing the road or creeks or
creeks,
rivers?
In Ohio, can't legally road trap. You got to have permission everywhere, which is a pain. Yeah, it's tough, which I still do that some. But so you wade and float. I've done both quite a bit. So I was a pocket set guy until the dog proofs come out. Now I run a lot more dog proofs than I do pockets, just like a lot of fellas. Now if I was somewhere in Ohio, most places I'm at, that's not much of a factor. We don't have a great mink population, but the only thing with the dog proofs is you're not going to catch any mink. If I was in Iowa or in Minnesota coon trapping and wanting to catch all the mink that come through too, I would probably lean more still towards being a pocket set guy.
Well, as many DPs as I've seen walking around here in people's hands,
yeah,
mink are pretty safe.
I think so too. Whenever the PVC pipe got hot, that set. I mean, you'll catch some mink that way, but not like you will on a pocket set. Now, I know I've read and talked to some guys, they'll puff up like a toad when they hear me say that. You can't catch very many mink in PVC pipe sets, but most guys I talk to that catch a lot of coon in them aren't catching very many mink.
I've done a lot of interviews, and we've never really talked about pockets.
Okay.
At all. So if Scott was going to teach someone how to make a pocket set, just because we've never covered it, mm-hmm. how would Scott do it?
The easiest way, I mean, I can explain it. I do it the Carol Black style, like in his coon trapping book, that
okay.
big old set, where you're cutting more of a, looks more like an oval hole in the bank, and that baby is deep, and it goes up as it goes back. It's a big hole. You know, it's kind of like everybody did them back in the 80s. That's how we did pockets. Now, we got... When I was just trapping coons and you were trying to run fast, you know, guys would just kick a toe in the bank and jam a piece of sucker in there and use some lure, and I've caught coon that way. But that big hole set, having that pocket rise as it comes out of the water level, you know, that slot in that pocket is when it's oval shaped like that, from the water edge to the top of that pocket, it might be 8 or 10 inches, and then back up in higher than that yet at the back of the pocket, that set can take a big water rise. And as long as part of that pocket's out of the water, you're not going to catch a lot of critters that way, but you'll still catch a few coons. You're not going to catch any mink with that deep water over the trap, but
now you,
it keeps that set working.
What was your trap placement on that?
I always center up on them. And here again, kind of refer back to blacking from my own experience, it's true, is when a coon's working a pocket set, I've never seen very many coon that are swimming down the middle of the creek and then making a parade left or a parade right turn to come into a pocket set straight. So if he's working the bank from either direction and coming into that big pocket set, he's gonna round that corner, and one leg's gonna hug the edge of that pocket, and the other one's gonna be more towards the center of that pocket. So actually, a center placed trap, and I've went over this some when I talk about predator trapping, is very few animals turn and approach that set straight on. Everybody says, well, they come from a 45 degree angle. Absolutely, that's true. They come from a downwind angle. So a center trap is actually offset to the animal's approach route.
Mm-hmm.
Because the way that on a pocket set, the way he's going to round that corner, is that trap being centered is offset either way he comes in. And I just find I have a lot fewer misses that way, okay, centering that trap up.
Were you doing drowners or chains?
On the big pockets, drowners, yeah, that was still. And like I said, now with the dog proofs and not having a big mink population, I just stake them down and let them make a catch circle. But when we were drowning everything, yeah, still running a lot of number 11 wire. And that was before the chain and rods really got popular.
Nothing's new. People just think it is.
Yeah. Well, like you said before, a mountain man almost eliminated all the beaver using chains on traps. So, absolutely, absolutely.
So, what are you doing? Quick rundown, like on your dog proofs. Do you have a lure bait that you're making for that?
Yep, I've got a fish bait which I call Lights Out, and that's, I think, to me. And I've got customers that buy our lure that's got shellfish essence in it, or loganberry, or persimmon, or any type of synthetic oil. To me, I don't put anything in a dog-proof trap that's not edible. If he puts his paw in there and gets a bite of it, I want him to put his paw back in. Most of the oils that are used in the trapping lure trade are synthetic, and they taste just like motor oil.
Right.
So anything I put in there, if it's the fish bait I use, or I use a lot of catfish pellets, which are dynamite. You read the ingredient label on a catfish pellet, like you use in a farm pond to feed catfish. It's fish meal, dried molasses, and beet pulp. Those are all coon foods. And the nice thing is about the dry baits is they don't freeze up.
Mm-hmm.
They don't get runny and run out the bottom when it rains. They'll get soft eventually. So as far as baiting dog proofs, those are the two things I use, is either a dry type bait or a edible fish type bait. Myself personally, like I said, I know guys that catch a lot of coon in them, but I don't like a shellfish oil base or a fruit oil base, just because 99% of the time those are fragrance oils. They're not flavor oils, so they have terrible bitter aftertaste.
Mm-hmm. That is true.
Yeah.
Yeah. What I've noticed about dog proofs that when I first got them, I was kind of disappointed. It was like, you almost, to be good at them, in my opinion, the way that I've always been successful, it's not like you're replacing a 220 with a dog proof. If you get out of that premise where you're off the trail, or I've never had any luck just setting them on the riverbank.
No, right, exactly. And I've been more that way too, Clint. And that's what guys say, well, use them catfish pellets, they don't hardly have any smell. I said, no, they don't. But I said, that trail's 8 inches wide, and that dog proof is right in the middle of it. He's going to bang his nose into it. He doesn't have to smell it. He's going to find it. But yeah, as far as, if a guy was, for instance, to say, okay, we're going to replace a dog proof with making a dirt hole set with number 2 coil in front of it, we're going to use the same location, he's going to be very disappointed with how the dog proofs work for him catching coons.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely, yeah. Yep. And I don't know why that is. I mean, you're losing some eye appeal, probably losing some nose appeal, but I think the eye appeal is a big thing on them, and guys paint them white and different things. But I still think if you've got that pocket set in the riverbank, for whatever reason, you're going to draw a coon in a lot better than you will just sticking a dog-proof trap along a bank just randomly because there's a coon in the area.
Well, when I first went out to Iowa, that was my premise.
Coons
walking in the creek.
Yeah.
I'd get away from the pockets, and I mean, I got my tail kicked until I realized that doesn't work, you know. And it was disappointing. And the other thing that to me, I still don't understand this. I can go put a dirt hole in the corner of a field and be cussing coon because they're messing up my
absolutely.
Cat. You go put a dog proof in the corner of a field, it'll sit there till it rusts.
Yes.
And just, I mean, it's like probably one out of 50 will catch something, and it's normally a possum.
I agree with that 100%. Yep. Why is that? I can't explain it to you, but that's just how it works. Yeah.
It is. But I do think that the dog proofs, with the way everybody's using them now, it's allowed people with very little skill or understanding, if they can find a coon trail, they can catch.
Absolutely. I always say you can train a monkey to use them, which is pretty good because that's about the same mentality level I'm on. So, but yeah.
3 weeks into the season running long lines, you need something a monkey can.
Absolutely. And they're not, I mean, you can set, I set them ahead of time, stack them in a milk crate at the back of the truck. And if you're using them on Earth Anchor with a quick clip or a quick link or something, you can grab 4 or 5 of them and you can set them so fast it's scary and be back in the truck. Absolutely.
Are you gang setting them pretty heavy?
Or? Yeah, and I think you have to. On them trails, and you and I have touched on this before, Clint, and we've talked about like using them on deer feeder trails in the south on them nuisance jobs. I don't know why it is, but if you set 2 dog proofs there and you catch 2 coons the first night, it's almost like that area will go dead sometimes. Not always, but sometimes it will, and the coons are still there. So, yeah, I'll set them heavy, and then move them every 3 or 4 days, especially if I'm getting good coon moving weather and when you're catching several a night and then just getting out of there and going on to somewhere else. Yeah.
Well, what we found with that is we started playing in Texas trying to figure out how to get around that situation. So when we have those big deer feeders with a high protein feed, we don't set the traps now probably within 40 or 50 yards, but we're setting every one of those up, and we'll come in, there'll be 3 coon on 3 different trails, and then there'll be 1 on that trail and 1 over here, and it never stops. But getting it right at that food source kills it.
It does.
And it doesn't make any sense.
No.
You know, but it just is. That's the way it is.
Yeah, for whatever reason. And at some point, you can try to explain it to yourself all the time, but you just ain't going to make it work. You got to try something else. That's right.
So how many places have you trapped?
Trap in Ohio, trapped in New York, and trapped in Mississippi. So just what I say, trap in 3 states. Now, I've been with guys and set traps in other states, but as far as running serious lines, those are the areas that I've been in, yeah.
Well, Ohio and New York's pretty close. I'm sure it's pretty similar.
Where I'm at in New York is kind of that between the Adirondacks and the Catskills, so it's a little geographically different, but the same basic types of locations and stuff, pretty similar to what I've got in Ohio, yeah.
Now, I'm going to pick on you, and when you went to Mississippi, I don't have to ask. I know it was different.
Oh, absolutely.
So, from someone, because that's another big thing with the weather up north and guys are getting more heavy, they're going to start going south. What have you noticed in the south that is different than being up north?
As far as weather, animal behavior,
animal behavior.
The thing I noticed is, one thing I noticed right off is that in Ohio, we get them nights, you'd have pretty good high pressure, and you'd get like a little bit of snow or something one night. And I'm in northern Mississippi, so they get snow quite a bit. And man, in Ohio, that would really make critters run, that little bit of snow. But in the south, it's just 180 degrees opposite for whatever reason. I mean, you don't see tracks, you don't see nothing. And then when things settle down, then you'll start to catch some fur again. The other thing I noticed a big difference is, and anybody that you talk to that tries to predator trap down south, is just the mud, the rain, the mud, it's that clay ground, and it's either mud or concrete. And I know in Ohio, you get them high pressure fronts that'll last 8 or 10 days, and man, I hated them because critters won't move. And it's same as essentially true in the south, but I can make up for that because I can actually keep sets working. So I love those long stretches of decent weather in the south versus in Ohio. I just work a lot harder and keep more sets working, and I can keep right on catching fur. But I haven't noticed the big spikes if you take the snow out of the equation. As far as how my catch is, I can maintain pretty good catch ratios once I get a line run. I don't have them big spikes and valleys in my catch like I seem to in Ohio and even in New York. If I can get a line running.
That they're right there. A lot of people haven't noticed it, but that when I get somewhere
further, I saw your eyes light up when I said that.
Oh, man, that drives me nuts.
Yeah. And that's one thing that frustrates me. especially in the East and in the Midwest, is so much of what we read information-wise has been written during the fur boom. We didn't have a great population of coyotes in the East, you know, just as many, especially with the otter market being good, and a lot of times when you're doing nuisance work, if them guys want to pay you to trap them, absolutely. But and here again, we talked earlier about being more old school, is that I'm not afraid. If I'm coyote and cat trapping, I can stop and catch some beaver and otter too, absolutely. And I'll catch, you know, I don't knock them dead, but if I'm down there predator trapping, I'll still catch, you know, 50, 60 beaver and catch 15, 20 otter down there while I'm trapping coyotes and cats and gray fox too. So, yeah, I don't want to drive by the animals.
You didn't grow up trapping otter though?
Oh, absolutely not. No.
So, are you catching your otter accidentally? Or are you targeting?
Targeting otter when I'm finding. Which where I'm at in Mississippi, I don't have a great otter population, and you don't find a lot of sign. But you'll find some crossovers and find some pullouts where you can target otters if you know what you're looking for. And it's kind of like trapping mink back in Ohio when you've got that lower population density. Is that usually those decent otter locations, I'll catch otters in the same spot. Unless things really change, I can go back in there and catch two or three otters in the same spots year after year after year. Yeah.
And on your beaver, are you pretty much 330 in it, or have you got into the foothold?
Probably about 80% 330s, and then the rest in caster mounds. Yeah, I don't foothold very many beaver when I'm down there, no.
Okay, now I'm going to play on your observation skills.
Absolutely, okay.
Since we're friends, I can do this. Mm-hmm. And I'm not going to mention any names because it'd get people's feelings hurt, but there's been a lot of guys that come from the north and go somewhere like Mississippi, Arkansas, Louisiana, Georgia, Tennessee, and they come down loaded bare for caster mound sets. And what has been your experience with trying that? Because it's different up here.
Yeah, absolutely. As far as in the south trying caster mounds, I mean, I catch some beaver that way, but if somebody was get mean with me and twist my arm and say, you can't take a number fours with you, I'd say, that's okay, I'll just take the 330s. Mm-hmm. For a lot of times where I'm at, one, the waters fluctuate so bad in the south up and down, it's tough to keep them working. And a lot of places I'm at, as far as wanting to get drowning rigs and stuff, it's not very conducive to that. To that type of trapping, and which here again, I have never trapped a lot of beaver. I'm not an expert on beaver behavior, but I don't seem like I get the response on the caster mounds like I do in the north. Yeah, absolutely.
Well, what floored me? This had to have been 10 years ago. I was trapping up in Michigan, and beaver season wasn't in yet. And I had caster there, and I didn't realize I didn't know that there were so many regulations when I started going north. Mm-hmm. So I just assumed if it was trapping season, you trapped whatever was around. But right. I had all this beaver stuff. And so I was like, well, I'll use this to start testing lure. And this was not springtime. It's not when they're, you know, all hot and bothered and coming off of ice. This was November. And I made a quick caster mound, and I smoothed everything out to sea, and I put lure down, and sure enough, it was destroyed. I mean, more than I've ever seen in my life.
Right.
So I would move that back. I was having beaver in Michigan in November coming 50 feet off the water to destroy the caster.
Isn't that something? Mm-hmm.
You do that, you get 3 foot off down there, and they could care less.
Absolutely, yeah.
And I was like, holy cow, I believe I could just like put a net behind the truck and drive slow down through these swamps and get beaver to come up. It was phenomenal to me.
Yep. And there again, I've had isolated areas or have incidents where the water's shallow, you get flooded areas where beavers have dammed it up. There's really no good runs. You know there's beavers in there, but you can't pinpoint them to really trap them. And I'll just cut a notch in a bank with a tile spade and put a 330 in the front of it. And I've caught some beaver and caster mounds that way. And it's ugly, and you wouldn't want to have anybody ever catch you
making a
set like that. But no, I agree. I haven't had great luck with building caster mounds in the south. I don't seem like I get the response on them like I think I should be.
So you're talking about, how are you dealing with the mud down when you go down there? Because you're in the gumbo part of the delta.
Oh, yeah, terrible. And I don't like to haul dirt with me. Anybody's talked to me, if I don't have to take it with me, I don't take it with me. So I sure don't haul Ohio dirt to Mississippi with me. But when I'm down there, when I've got dry days, I'm a madman with a tile spade and a 5 gallon pail. And I fill buckets and fill buckets and fill buckets and put them in the barn where I stay. And I use peat moss some, and you just fight and do whatever you have to do. I think the big thing is guys, they ask questions like that, just like with freezing and thawing weather in the north or in the Midwest. The guys think, well, how do you deal with that? They think there's some special magic thing you're not doing,
there is.
Somebody else
is
doing.
And
it's hard work.
And I tell them, it goes south.
Yeah, it goes south. I said, that stuff just sucks for everybody. There's no easy way around it. You're just up to your shoulders in mud, and you're rebuilding sets. Now I've got a way. I use a big Charlie Robbins style dirt a whole lot, and I still do. You know, when that sun's shining, that dirt's dry. My ratios, I try to make myself make 50-50 flats and dirt holes. And we're kind of getting off the original topic here, and guys say, well, you think flat sets are better than dirt holes for coyotes? Or, you know, you get into a whole other argument. I don't know if one's necessarily better than the other, but I know if I dig a 4-inch dirt hole 18 inches in the ground and it rains, I'm not a smart fellow, but I know water runs downhill, and that's going to be a pond by the time I get back there. So a flat set will take a lot more water. So you build more flat sets and try to find places that maybe drain a little bit better. But I don't ever let that weather, you know, if I think it's going to rain, there's a little bit of a low spot, I'm seeing a lot of sign, by God, I'm going to set it, and if it rains, I'll just remake sets. And I think you have to go into that situation with your eyes open up to know it's going to get muddy and they're going to flood out and I'm going to have to rebuild sets. I've got to where I've used drags a lot more than I ever used to. The one thing I like about that, like I'm talking, you get a real good micro location, and you make a catch there and it rains 3 inches at night. I mean, it's a wallow hole. They ruin it. And sometimes some of those spots are so tight on a good location. If you're in CRP ground or you're in a pine thicket, you don't really want to move 8 feet from where you're at. You want to be right here. That's why you sat there in the first place, where you put him on a drag. At least you're not, it's still wet, but you haven't wallowed out that nice micro location. So I've done that more and more. And even if I'm somewhere where I don't think he's going to hook up with a drag, I would still run 8 or 10 foot of chain and just run a half inch rebar stake through that last swivel right at the drag. And, you know, he'll tangle up somewhere close anyway, but he's not making a great big wall a hole where I've got that location. But as far as, like I said, set construction or anything, I do different. I try to lean more towards the flat sets, but yeah, I just gather dry dirt. And
are you on a four wheeler?
All the time down there,
all
yeah.
The time. You almost have to be.
You have to be down there. If you're walking, I mean, I've got places that first set might be a mile and a half from the rig, from where I parked the truck. And you just can't, I mean, that ground is such, out of a pickup truck, I don't know if you could, some of that, you just can't get around when it's wet. You've got to have a four-wheeler or a ute of some sort, yeah.
The first time I went to Mississippi, it was Bluebird days, about the first four, and I think all trapping trips start that way.
Mm-hmm, because it sucks you in.
Yeah, it's just perfect, and you get all these sets out, and I was on a four-wheeler there at the farm we were on, and it rained, and my God, I never seen mud like that in my life. First time ever dealing is in Mississippi, the southern Mississippi, but in the Delta. And then the next day, the sun came out, and it started shining. Well, then the mud would get so thick on the four-wheeler
that it the tires up.
It would stop
the turn.
So I'm out there with a shovel getting that off, going, this is crazy.
Yeah.
And one of the old guys there was working there, old black man, he says, you got to go from water hole to water hole. Now, in my mind, if you go from water hole to water hole, you're going to get more mud. Where I live in Tennessee,
absolutely,
you stay out of the mud
right.
When it's wet.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, it's the only way you'll keep that. When every time you go through it, you go from water hole to water hole.
Take the tires off.
And he said, give it gas, it would clean all that off. And then by the time it built up and you almost had to scrape, you'd come to another waller and you could crank that thing
up. Yeah, I've heard horror stories of guys getting mad and boring around in that stuff and burning up transmissions and doing all kinds of bad things. Yeah,
I mean, it's of course they're not big now, but at the time a 650 Polaris was a big four wheeler,
mm-hmm.
and it would stop it dead in its tracks.
Yeah. Yep.
Well, you're going to be at the Ohio convention.
Yes, sir. Yep.
Okay. If you don't mind, I've guided you off of coyotes because I want to pick your brain for about 40 minutes there in Ohio.
Okay.
What other conventions are you going to be at?
I'm going to be at the Michigan convention this year, up in Everett.
Everett,
which is in 2 weeks, I think, from this weekend here to Nationals, August 17th and 18th. And that's probably going to about do us for the year. I got some instructions lined up on weekends, so we probably won't do. We do some years a little one-day shows, but we're probably getting to where we're getting busy enough. We're starting to back out of some of them. But so from now on out, it's just those two shows that I'm aware of. Yeah,
and
just
then
Ohio
they get a hold
and Michigan.
Of you at your website.
Yep, and they can check us out at WelchLures.com. Yep.
Okay, and you're not going to tell us what your new site's about.
Nope, but we got we're going to we got some blog posts on there. Got some information. It's not just advertisement. and have some things where guys can be a little more interactive with that stuff. So I just urge everybody to check that out. Actually, we're hoping it's going to get launched this week while we're up here at the Nationals, but probably within the next...
It never works.
No, but probably the next week to 10 days. So
You don't mind if I pick your brain again in Ohio?
Absolutely not. I look forward to it.
Well, I appreciate it, Scott.
Yep, thank you, Clint.
All right, bud.